Good morning, LifeBridge family. Hope all of you are doing well. It is great to be back with you online. We're grateful that you guys are continuing to join us online. Whatever time of day it is that you are watching this, thank you for letting us come into your homes, into your cars, into your space, and continue to minister to you. I do want to ask that this weekend, as we remember the 4th of July weekend, as we're celebrating freedom, that we're reminded of the freedom that is greater than what our nation has to offer, and that is freedom in Christ. Oftentimes we overlook this, we certainly take that for granted, but that is a freedom that is worth celebrating every single day. Enjoy your time celebrating fireworks and cookouts. Hopefully you will get to participate in some activities with family and friends, and I hope all of this is wonderful, but may we never forget the sacrifice, the blood sacrifice that was also made on our behalf. And that's for the forgiveness of sins and the amazing grace that God demonstrated by offering up his son. May we never forget that and take it for granted. Hey, let's pray, and then we're going to jump into our sermon today. Father, we love you, and we thank you for the freedom that we share. Lord, we thank you for just the opportunity that we have to reflect Christ to our nation as individuals. Lord, there's certain places around the world that Christianity and the movement of Jesus is in secret. But God, we are blessed enough that we get to live this out publicly. And Lord, I pray that we do that. I pray that as individuals who have this freedom, we let our light shine to others. And God, I pray that this light penetrates into darkness, God. It's not us, but it's you. And so may we take full advantage of the freedom that we have. Lord, be with us today as we dive into your word. Lord, I pray that your word teaches us, that it encourages us, that it corrects behavior. Lord, I pray that it meets us where we are so that we can deepen our journey, deepen our faith journey with you. We love you, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. So today is our last sermon in this series of stories rarely taught in Sunday school. And we're going to revisit this in the future because there are several stories that go untold and several stories that go untaught. And for me, this has just been a fun series. It's been a series of study, of deeper study, of becoming familiar with new passages that seldom get looked at. And so we're going to revisit this in the future. I do want to remind everybody what Paul wrote to Timothy. You know, speaking of Scripture, he says that all Scripture is God-breathed, and it's useful for teaching, it's useful for correcting, for training up in righteousness. All of it. All Scripture is beneficial to our lives. And so we've been looking at these rare stories that we don't really read about, stories that if we read, they're entertaining, and we move on. And so we have another one for you today. Another story for you today that you're probably familiar with. You might have heard a sermon on it somewhere along the line, but it's something that something that is rarely ever taught on. And so I've got another one. Here it is. It comes from 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 1 through 7, and I'm going to read from the ESV today. So if you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Kings. Now the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, "See, the place where we dwell under your charge is too small for us. Let us go to the Jordan, and each of us get there a log, and let us make a place for us to dwell there." And he answered, "Go." Then one of them said, "Be pleased to go with your servants." And he answered, "I will go." So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was felling a log, his axe head fell into the water, and he cried out, "Alas, my master, it was borrowed." Then the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" When he showed him the place, he cut off a stick and threw it in there and made the iron float. And he said, "Take it up." So he reached out his hand and he took it. So Elisha, this is the backstory, if you will. Elisha is the hand-selected student that Elijah picked to be his successor. And what we need to remember about Elisha is that as this transaction of Elijah into Elisha being the main prophet, as this transaction is taking place, he asked God for a double portion. Double the portion of the Holy Spirit that was given to Elijah. I mean, that's a bold move, right? Like, Elijah is known as one of the greatest prophets. He is the greatest prophet at that time period. He's a man of God. He challenged Baal and all the prophets of Baal. And Elisha comes on the scene. He says, "You know what? If I'm going to be the next guy in charge, I want a double portion of your spirit in my life." And God obliges. He listens to him and he says, "Okay, I will do that." And so Elisha, when you read through the rest of the story, Elisha goes on to be involved with twice as many miracles as Elijah. And so Elijah has gone on. Elisha is now training up more prophets, more messengers for God. And their group was growing and it was running out of space. So they go to their teacher and they ask permission to expand their living quarters. And then they say, hey, can we also do this down by the river? Elisha grants them permission, but then someone speaks up for the students. And he says, Elisha, will you also go with us? And so they get down to the river's bank, and as they begin to work, one of the students loses his axe into the river with this detail: it was borrowed. Elisha steps in. He's asked, where did it fall in? And then he takes a stick. He goes and he cuts a stick down, and he takes it and he throws the stick into the river, and the iron floats to the top. That's a cool story, right? And we love cool stories, and we certainly love cool stories with happy endings, and we're grateful for this guy, and we're glad that it worked out well for him. But as we said, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful, it's profitable for my life. And so what does this story have to do with my life? Well, I've enjoyed studying this one, and I've come up with about four things that I want to share with you. The first one is this: crisis. Crisis is the first word I typed when I went through my routine of sermon prep. Upon reading this passage a couple of times, I felt bad for this young prophet who is working hard and who loses this tool into the river. Not only did he lose a tool, he lost a borrowed tool, which makes it worse. And some of you might, well, maybe not. No, I'd much rather lose somebody else's tool than lose mine. But no, this was a big deal because he was responsible for this. Someone trusted him to use this and then to return it at a later point in time. You know, it was impressed upon me growing up that when you borrow something, you return it better than you received it. And I remember in our little community where we grew up, it's a farming community, that we would borrow this piece of equipment and we would, you know, I'd be responsible. I'd go over and I'd hook it up and I'd, you know, use the, whether it was a bush hog or hay cutter or hay rake or whatever the case may be, we would borrow this piece of equipment and we always kind of cleaned it off. We would always knock the grass off of it. We would always, you know, grease it up or whatever the case may be before we returned it. And when you borrow something, it's just a nice gesture to return it nicer than what you received it. And now, for whatever reason, this guy has borrowed this tool. The axe head was jarred loose and it fell into the deep river below. Now, this may not seem like a big deal to you and I. I mean, first off, you know, an axe is an archaic tool that seldom gets used by too many of us. I can't remember the last time I used an axe. And if, when I used it, I'm pretty sure I didn't use it for its intended purpose. All right. Secondly, we can replace an axe after picking up a gallon of milk and walking to the other side of Walmart. That's how readily available these things are. So losing an axe head, for us, not that big a deal. But this student does not have the luxury of Walmart. For this worker, he is facing a crisis. And what is a crisis to you may not be a big deal to me. Take our environment that we're living in right now. For some of us, this COVID-19 is extremely serious. For others, it's just a minor interruption in life. The reality is, Crises are certainly going to happen in life. Whether it be health issues, whether it be financial issues, whether it be relational issues, we will face a crisis. It's going to happen. Jesus guarantees that as followers, as his followers, we are going to face troubles. So if this is true, how do we prepare for these moments? If certain unknown challenges will be part of life, how do we prepare for them now? I've got one answer for you. The best way to prepare for a crisis is to already be in the presence of God. I'll say that again. The best way for you and I to prepare for a crisis is to already be in the presence of God. These students were wise in asking the messenger of God, Elisha, the one who performed more miracles than anyone this side of Jesus, to go with them. They were already in God's presence. The best way for you and I to prepare for crises is to already be in the presence of God. You know, in the financial coaching world, Dave Ramsey teaches that everyone needs an emergency savings account. You know, as you're going through the debt snowball, he says that you need a minimum of $1,000 in a savings fund. And then once you become debt-free, you need 3 to 6 months worth of expenses set aside for emergencies. The logic is Murphy's Law. Whatever can go wrong will go wrong. Now, the savings does not keep a force field around us where you're protected from things going wrong. The savings prepares you for when these things happen. The same is true with God. Our relationship with Him doesn't keep us from having a crisis. It prepares us for them. And so my question is, why wait on the crisis to bring us to our knees, begging for His help in our lives? Why do we wait until that moment hits to ask God for His help and His provision, for His blessing? We need to be proactive in spending time with God and not reactive. The second thing I noticed in this story is that everyone is working. Look at verse 2. Let us go to the Jordan, and each of us get there a log, and let us make a place for us to dwell there. Each of us has a part to play in God's economy. It's a theme throughout Paul's writing to the church, is that everyone has this role to play. Everyone needs to be involved with the giftings and the abilities that God has blessed them with. And in this story, each person there is working. And not just working, they're doing the daunting task of actually each one of us getting a log to contribute, to build to this structure that we're going to be living in. Have you heard the story of the four men who showed up to do an important job? It goes like this. Listen closely. Once upon a time, there were four men named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was asked to do it. But everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry about it because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought that anybody could do it, and nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. It ended up that everybody blamed somebody and nobody did the job that anybody could have done in the first place. We have all lived that, haven't we? Whether it's serving in the church or being assigned a group project back in our high school and college days, or some job in our profession today. Elisha is training these men, and in their desire to get through the building project, each one has to do his part. Let each of us get a log and let us build a place to dwell. How fitting that this story speaks of a building project. If you've been following along online, reading our announcements, you know that we have relaunched a campaign entitled Restore His House. And we're trying to raise $35,000 for phase one to do some exterior work, to do some interior work. Most of this is maintenance. It's updating. It's taking care of God's house so that it's just better. Okay. I received a call this week from someone in our church that wants to challenge our congregation to give toward our Restore His House campaign this month. See, we're trying to raise a total of $7,000 by July 26 to go ahead and start some of the interior projects, to get those done before our kids go back to their classes, and as things become a little more normal again around here, we want all the interior projects to have already been taken care of. And we feel that we need to have $7,000 raised. Now, we're about halfway there. We have about $3,400 at the time of this video. Well, I have a family that called up, and they said, hey, we want to challenge the congregation that we will match up to $2,000 given between today and July 26. So gifts up to $2,000, they're going to match. And so if all of us will do our part, and I've been challenging the church, I've been asking you guys to pray about this and to consider what you can give during this time period. If all of us will do our part, we will crush this small goal of having $7,000 raised by July 26. And so I want to encourage you, talk it over with your spouse. Look at the budget for this month. Can you, will you, how much will you give? Remember that everything that we receive up to $2,000 is going to be doubled. Hopefully you will consider that and take a little bit of encouragement from this story, seeing that everyone had a part to play. The third observation from this story that I want to encourage you with is the detail of verse 3. Right, so if you look at it, it reads like this. Then one of them said, be pleased to go with your servants. And he answered, I will go. We focus on discipleship a lot around here, and I'm excited about the summer training that is taking place with our life group leaders. We're having a internal DS1 that's coming up in August. I know that I've renewed discipling relationships, and I'm just excited to see how this is flowing and filtering into our church. This is essentially what Elisha was doing with these students. He's discipling them. He's training them up in the way of God to release them out to influence other people. That's what his role is here as a prophet. And so he's got this school, if you will. He's got this opportunity, and he's speaking into, man, many, many prophets. And he's training them up to be messengers of God. Now, building a new dwelling was most likely not part of this training. Right? Like, that's we're not going to teach you these hands-on things over here. It was how to be a messenger, how to be a prophet. And so they asked their teacher, though, hey, will you go with us? Be part of this task that you certainly don't have to be part of. Right? Like, that's what they're asking him to do. Hey, you don't have to go with us and build this. We got this on our own. Thank you for your blessing, Elisha. Thank you for the permission that you've given us to do this. But will you go with us to do this? And Elisha shows up. He shows us something here that is really important. Discipling people is so much more than just teaching. It's so much more than sharing facts and information. Discipling people is about being present in their lives. Being present in their lives so that when a crisis hits, you're already there. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. We've all heard that. This is what Elisha is demonstrating. He does not hesitate to do so. And you and I, most likely in our discipling relationships, we most likely don't have the ability to perform a miracle. But don't count your presence in the lives of someone who is going through something as some worthless act. That is important. When I think back on my life and when I think back on difficult times, and in ministry, I've certainly had those, whether that be personal failures or challenges that were above anything. Let me rephrase that. When I think about my life and going through difficult times, whenever those are personal challenges or things outside of my control, what I remember most is the people who showed up. I may not necessarily remember all the words of encouragement. I know I learned lessons and I remember advice given. But what I really remember, the comfort, the encouragement, came from their presence in my life. And I get told time and time again when people are going through things as a pastor, just being there. It's one of those things that we encourage our life group leaders to be the front line. We encourage our life groups to be the front line for this, of meeting needs and being there for crisis. And so many people ask me over and over and over again in dealing with these situations, I don't know what to say. And the truth of the matter is, we learn from Elisha in this, it doesn't really matter what you say. What matters is that your presence there when they are going through it. In other stories, and we see this in the book of Acts, Jesus assures the disciples, don't worry. In those moments, God will give you the words to say. The important thing that we need to learn from Elisha in this story is that even though he didn't have to go, he went with them and he was present with them in the middle of a crisis. The last thing I want to share with you comes from one of the commentaries I was reading. It comes from the author Keith Brooks. And I really want this to encourage you. Those of you that are praying for people right now, those of you who have family members or people in your life who are distant from God, I really want you to pay attention to this point. This is what Keith Brooks writes. As God raised the iron against the natural laws of physics, so his grace can raise the iron heart which has sunk into the mud of this world. Yeah, that's worth repeating. As God raised the iron against the natural laws of physics, so his grace can raise the iron heart which has sunk into the mud of this world. You know, iron in the shape of an axe head is not buoyant. It's going to sink, and it will drop like iron into the bottom of any body of water. God raised the iron against the natural laws of physics. This is a demonstration of his grace. This man wasn't necessarily deserving of it, of a miracle, but God's grace is there for all of us. His grace is sufficient to also raise the iron-hardened heart of someone who is sunk into the mud of this world. You know these people. They have hardened hearts right now. They live the way they want to live. They live without a relationship with God. You know these people. And just like this student who cried out to his master, we too must cry out to ours. It may take more than once. This guy was fortunate enough that Elisha was standing there and he was able to say, "Alas, my master, it was borrowed. It fell in." We have to believe that God is capable of softening the hardened hearts of those we care about. We may have to cry out more than once. We've heard stories in our church in the history of LifeBridge of people that we prayed for literally for years, that God softened their hearts and he brought them back to them. He is capable of raising these people out of the murky, muddy depths of which they are choosing to live. But you and I must be faithful and persistent as we believe and cry out on their behalf. Hope you guys have a great weekend celebrating our freedom. But more importantly, celebrate every day the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. I can't wait to see you guys.
Let's all sing these words together this morning. I've heard. Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I never your way. You are you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.